COVID-19 एन आई ओपनर। आई एम डॉक्टर परिधि शिवदे, प्रोफेसर ऑफ मेडिसिन, MGM मेडिकल कॉलेज, इंदौर। क्लिनिकल प्रेजेंटेशन। फीवर, डिज़निया एंड कफ आर मेन कंप्लेंट्स। अकॉर्डिंग टू CDC, दैट इज सेंटर ऑफ डिसीज कंट्रोल इन यूनाइटेड स्टेट्स, अ रिपोर्ट ऑफ 370,000 कन्फर्म पेशेंट्स शो कफ एंड फीवर इज द मेन कंप्लेन, फॉलोड बाय डिज़निया, फॉलोड बाय सोर थ्रोट, डायरिया, नौशिया एंड वॉमिटिंग, लॉस ऑफ स्मेल एंड टेस्ट, एब्डोमिनल पेन सीन इन लेस देन 10% ऑफ पेशेंट्स। इन सम अदर स्टडीज एनोजमिया, दैट इज लॉस ऑफ स्मेल, एंड डिसगोएसिया, दैट इज चेंज ऑफ टेस्ट, इज सीन इन 40% ऑफ पेशेंट्स। COVID-19 कॉम्प्लिकेशंस, रेस्पिरेटरी कॉम्प्लिकेशंस, रेस्पिरेटरी फेलियर, एक्यूट रेस्पिरेटरी डिस्ट्रेस सिंड्रोम ARDS, कार्डियक कॉम्प्लिकेशंस, एरिथमियाज। मोस्ट कॉमन एरिथमिया सीन इन COVID-19 इज साइनस टेकीकार्डिया, अदर्स आर पॉलीमॉर्फिक और मोनोमॉर्फिक वेंट्रिकुलर टेकीकार्डिया। ब्रेडी एरिथमियाज लाइक हार्ट ब्लॉक आर लेस कॉमनली सीन। हार्ट फेलियर इज ऑल्सो सीन इन अ स्मॉल रेट्रोस्पेक्टिव स्टडी इन सीरियसली इल पेशेंट्स इन वुहान। हार्ट फेलियर इज सीन इन 49% पेशेंट्स हु डाइड एंड 3% पेशेंट्स हु रिकवर्ड। मायोकार्डियल इंजरी, इंक्रीज कार्डियक ट्रोपोनिन लेवल इन 7-28% ऑफ पेशेंट्स। मायोकार्डियल इन्फार्क्शन इज ऑल्सो रिपोर्टेड। मायोकार्डियल इंजरी मे बी ड्यू टू स्ट्रेस कार्डियोमायोपैथी, हाइपोक्सिक इंजरी, इश्चिमिक इंजरी कॉज्ड बाय कार्डियक माइक्रोवेस्क्युलर डैमेज और एपिकार्डियल कोरोनरी आर्टरी डिसीज, एंड इट मे बी ड्यू टू साइटोकाइन स्टॉर्म, दैट इज सिस्टमिक इन्फ्लेमेटरी रिस्पॉन्स सिंड्रोम। A case report from St. Luke's University, USA shows that bradycardia in patients with COVID-19 may be a warning sign of onset of cytokine storm. Other complications, thromboembolic complications, risk of venous thromboembolism, VTE, increase in 25-43% of patients in ICU, often despite prophylactic anticoagulant therapy. Pulmonary embolism can also occur. Stroke reported in less than 50 years of age of patients without risk factors. There may be limb ischemia also. Secondary infections can be there, bacterial and fungal. Renal complications like acute kidney injury. Neurological complications. In half of hospitalized patients, some neurological complaints are present, like headache, dizziness, myalgia, alteration of consciousness, disorders of smell and taste, weakness, stroke, and seizures. Encephalopathy seen in critically ill patients, MRI brain, EEG and CSF should be done. Stroke, that is seen in 1-3% of patients. Ischemic stroke is more common. Hemorrhagic stroke and CVT can also occur. Number of cases of Guillain-Barré syndrome are also reported. Rare cases of acute disseminated encephalomyelitis, ADEM, and meningoencephalitis are also seen. Happy hypoxemia. One of the aspects of coronavirus disease, COVID-19, puzzling clinicians coping with the management of pneumonia, that one of the disease's complications is the presentation of patients with extremely low blood oxygenation but no sensation of dyspnea. Mechanism is unclear. As a complication of COVID-19, there is case report fibrotic interstitial lung disease occurring as a sequel of COVID-19 pneumonia despite concomitant steroids by Dr. Zareer Farooq Udwadia, who is a renowned chest physician at Hinduja Hospital, Mumbai. Stages of COVID-19 infection. First stage, that is early infection, in which there is viral response phase, in which there may be features of viremia, that is fever, high grade fever, severe myalgias, prostrations. In this stage, that is first week, antiviral should be started. If plasma is planned, that should also be given early in first week. Stage 2, that is pulmonary phase, where viral response has decreased but inflammatory response has started. In this stage, steroids should be given, and if there is indication of immunomodulators for cytokine storm, it should also be started. Don't start steroids in first stage, that is on day 1. In first stage, start with antivirals. Steroids being most potent immunosuppressants, it suppress patient's own immune system, and using steroids without hypoxemia can worsen viremia. Even if a patient starts stable, patient can worsen from 7 to 10 days of illness due to host inflammatory response phase. Investigations. For confirmation of COVID-19, real-time RT-PCR, that is reverse transcriptase polymerase chain reaction, in nasopharyngeal swab, oropharyngeal swab, sputum and bronchoalveolar lavage. It is gold standard test. Then rapid detection by antigen test. In May 20, it was issued emergency use authorization by FDA. Results come in 30 minutes and it should be done in emergency procedures before emergency surgeries or dialysis. Antibody test. CRP. C-reactive protein increases in severe inflammation. According to study results published in Open Forum Infectious Disease, increased CRP may be a predictive marker in determining which patients with mild disease will progress to severe disease. So it is more specific marker to assess disease progression. It is cheaper, results come early, and it should be serially repeated. In studies, CRP was found elevated in patients who died of COVID-19. So it could be a promising biomarker for assessing disease lethality. CRP levels more than 100 mg per liter is significant. Less than 8 mg per liter. Usually, increased D-dimer is also associated with increased CRP level. D-dimer and LDH. D-dimer is predictor of thromboembolic condition. Increased D-dimer is associated with mortality. Normal D-dimer level is less than 500 nanogram per ml. If it is more than 1000 nanogram per ml, it is considered significant. LDH. It is associated with severe COVID disease. Some studies also show increased mortality in patients with increased LDH, but larger studies are needed to confirm this finding. LDH more than 245 units per liter is considered abnormal. Normal is 110 to 210 units per liter. Ferritin levels. Hyperferritinemia is associated with inflammatory state. It is associated with severity of disease and disease progression. More than 500 micrograms per liter is considered abnormal. Procalcitonin level. It has a great specificity in identifying sepsis, and it can be used in diagnosis of bacterial infections. It may be associated with severe disease. Interleukin 6. Studies show increased interleukin 6 levels seem to be associated with inflammatory response, respiratory failure leading to mechanical ventilation, and mortality in COVID-19. Complete blood count and liver function test. In CBC, lymphopenia seen in 83% hospitalized COVID patients, it is associated with increased mortality. Absolute lymphocyte count is less than 800 per microliter. In LFT, there may be increase in the liver enzymes. Electrolytes, blood sugar, HbA1c, renal function tests, urea, creatinine should also be done. X-ray chest, HRCT chest. American College of Radiology does not recommend CT scan chest for screening or as the first line test for diagnosis of COVID-19. Because of variabilities of CT scan findings, and findings may not be present in first few days of illness. ECG, echocardiography, treatment. Antivirals. Any antiviral is most effective when used early. There is decrease in viral load, duration of virus shedding, and symptom improvement. Antivirals remdesivir and favipiravir. Remdesivir, FDA approved in May 20. It is a 10-year-old antiviral drug and with largest evidence based. It was found effective against SARS and MERS virus, but was when tested against Ebola and Marburg virus, it was found ineffective. Many multinational randomized controlled trials on remdesivir in severe COVID infection published in NEJM and Lancet all show same result. There is shorter time to recovery in comparison to placebo, median 11 days as compared to 15 days, patient getting well 3 to 4 days faster, but it has no impact on mortality. Remdesivir is given IV, single loading dose of 200 mg and maintenance dose of 100 mg daily. 5 days course is as effective as 10 days treatment in hospitalized severe disease. According to FDA, liver function test should be tested in all patients prior to starting remdesivir and daily while receiving remdesivir. Studies in Journal of American Medical Association showed that in milder cases, remdesivir may not be used or may not be needed. In May 20, FDA has approved the use of remdesivir limited to severe disease. Severe disease, that is oxygen saturation less than or equal to 94% in room air, or requiring supplemental oxygen, or requiring mechanical ventilation, और मोर देन 50% ऑफ लंग इन्वॉल्वमेंट। बट ऑन अगस्त 28, 2020 FDA broadens emergency use authorization for remdesivir to include all hospitalized patients suspected or laboratory confirmed irrespective of their severity of disease. Then few days back on October 22, FDA has approved remdesivir for use in adults and in pediatric patients 12 years of age or more and weighing at least 40 kg for the treatment of COVID-19 requiring hospitalization. Side effects of remdesivir: hepatotoxicity, elevated hepatic enzymes, gastrointestinal side effects, constipation, nausea, diarrhea, vomiting, and poor appetite. Respiratory failure was seen in around 4% of patients in a study Grand et al. Published in NAJM. Cardiovascular side effects: hypotension, atrial fibrillation, hypernatremia. Renal side effects: renal impairment, acute kidney injury. Anemia can also be there. Other side effects like hyperglycemia and hypokalemia. FDA in June 20 warned for the use of hydroxychloroquine with remdesivir as hydroxychloroquine may decrease antiviral activity of remdesivir. Favipiravir. It is an experimental antiviral drug not yet FDA or European Union approved but available in many countries including India. DCGI, that is Disease Controller General of India, approved it in June 20 for COVID-19 infections. It also works against broad range of influenza viruses. It is oral drug, less priced than remdesivir, probably most effective in mild to moderate COVID-19 disease who are not hospitalized. Use early in symptomatic patients with lot of symptoms of viremia, including high grade fever on day 1 or 2, severe myalgia and prostrations. Side effects: increased transaminases, diarrhea, decreased WBC count, hyperuricemia, increased triglyceride level. Dose is 1800 mg twice a day on day 1 followed by 800 mg BD for 2 to 14 days. Around 5 to 7 days course is used in various studies. Disadvantage is high pill burden. Convalescent plasma therapy. FDA granted emergency use authorization for plasma therapy on August 23, 2020 for use of convalescent plasma in hospitalized patients with COVID-19. After this, Mayo Clinic, which was conducting FDA-sponsored COVID-19 expanded access program, discontinued enrollment on 28 August 20. Eligible donors with high titers of antibodies are selected. Transfusion should be done to the patients early within 3 days of illness, as many patients who were planning for plasma develop their own antibody for virus by around 10 days. Slight improvement in mortality was found in patients who received plasma in Mayo Grip observational study. NIH, COVID-19 guidelines panel concluded on August 20 that there are insufficient data to either recommend for or against the use of convalescent plasma for treatment of COVID-19. Cochrane review of convalescent plasma use in patients with COVID-19 in July 20 expressed uncertainty to the benefits of convalescent plasma in terms of mortality at hospital discharge, prolonging time to death, or improving clinical symptoms at 7 to 28 days. Adverse effects can be like transfusion-transmitted infections such as HIV, hepatitis B, hepatitis C. There may be allergic reactions, anaphylactic reactions, transfusion-related acute lung injury, transfusion-associated circulatory overload, and hemolytic reactions. Steroids. In meta-analysis of randomized clinical trials in JAMA, Journal of American Medical Association, shows that in clinically ill patients with COVID-19, administration of systemic steroids was associated with lower 28 days all-cause mortality in comparison to usual care or placebo. Large study recovery trial showed that mortality rate was lower among patients who received dexamethasone in comparison to patients who received a standard care. But dexamethasone shows no benefit among patients who don't need oxygen or respiratory support. As we know, steroid is most potent immunosuppressant and suppresses patient's own immune system. It is said not to start steroids on day one, start when inflammatory response is more, that is 5th to 7th day. Chinese Thoracic Society and National Institute of Health, USA, both says that steroids should not be used in patients without hypoxemia. It should be used in patients with hypoxemia. So, Chinese Thoracic Society states that steroids should be used with caution in patients with hypoxemia with COVID-19, and dose administration should be less than 0.5 mg per kg per day methylprednisolone or equivalent, and for a shorter duration, that is less than 7 days. Short time use is safe except temporary hyperglycemia. NIH, National Institute of Health, a part of US Department of Health and Human Services, NIH Treatment Guidelines Panel recommend using dexamethasone 6 mg per day for up to 10 days or until hospital discharge in hospitalized patients who are on mechanical ventilation or requiring supplemental oxygen. Panel recommends against using dexamethasone for treatment of patients who do not require oxygen. If dexamethasone is not available, panel recommend alternatives such as prednisolone, methylprednisolone, or hydrocortisone. Anticoagulants. COVID-19 patients frequently develop procoagulative state. Mechanism is poorly understood. It is caused by virus-induced endothelial dysfunction, cytokine storm, and complement cascade activation. It is common to observe diffuse microvascular thrombi in multiple organs, mostly in pulmonary microvessels. High D-dimer levels are associated with poor prognosis. National Institute of Health, antithrombotic therapy in patients with COVID-19 in May 20 states that measure hematological and coagulation parameters, example D-dimer, PT, platelet count, fibrinogen in hospitalized patients. All hospitalized patients with COVID-19 should receive venous thromboembolism prophylaxis. Low molecular weight heparin is preferred. Hospitalized patients with COVID-19 should not routinely be discharged on VTE prophylaxis. Immunomodulators, tocilizumab. It is FDA-approved immunosuppressive drug for the treatment of active rheumatoid arthritis. Currently, FDA has not approved tocilizumab for treatment of COVID-19. It is interleukin-6 receptor antagonist and it does not act against interleukin-12, interleukin-1 beta and tumor necrosis factor alpha, which are other cytokines which are released in cytokine storm. It is used in treatment of cytokine storm. Studies like IMPACTA trial in September 20 shows that tocilizumab decreases the risk of mechanical ventilation or death in patients with COVID-19 pneumonia. Roche, that is the company which produces tocilizumab, confirmed that phase 3 COVACTA study in July 20 shows that tocilizumab failed to meet the endpoints. Primary endpoint of improving clinical status in COVID-associated pneumonia and secondary endpoint of decreasing mortality. But Roche committed to continue the trial and also to study combination with antivirals. NIH treatment panel also recommend against the use of tocilizumab for treatment of COVID-19. There is risk of infections with use of tocilizumab. Side effects are abnormal LFT, neutropenia, upper respiratory tract infections, nasopharyngitis, headache, increased blood pressure, increased total cholesterol, dizziness, rash, gastritis, and subcutaneous injection site reactions. Few words about hydroxychloroquine. It was initially started as treatment of COVID-19 patients. Studies show that HCQS have no impact on clinical outcome and mortality. Large studies like Solidarity Trial, Recovery Trial, National Institute of Health USA, and Novartis-sponsored HCQS trial all closed HCQS limb in a study and stopped it as a drug of trial and moved on with other drugs in trial. On July 19, WHO discontinues hydroxychloroquine and lopinavir-ritonavir treatment arms for COVID-19 by accepting recommendation from Solidarity International Steering Committee. FDA news release in June 15, 2020 in coronavirus update says that FDA revokes, that is cancels, emergency use authorization for hydroxychloroquine in COVID-19. So it's end of road for hydroxychloroquine in COVID-19 and it is not currently recommended for the treatment of COVID-19. Side effects of short duration use of hydroxychloroquine: nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, skin rash. But serious side effects like QT interval prolongation and ventricular arrhythmias. Indian Council of Medical Research, ICMR, has advised chemoprophylaxis of hydroxychloroquine in two groups. First is asymptomatic healthcare workers and asymptomatic household contacts. In asymptomatic healthcare workers who are involved in treating confirmed or suspected cases of COVID-19, SCQS should be given in 400 mg on day 1, followed by 400 mg once weekly for next 7 weeks. University of Oxford is doing large clinical trial, COPCOV trial, of hydroxychloroquine to prevent COVID-19 on around 40,000 healthcare workers, and results are pending now. Then asymptomatic household contacts of all laboratory confirmed COVID-19 cases, SCQS given 400 mg BD on day 1, followed by 400 mg once weekly for next 3 weeks. Study shows negative result and no benefit. Update from Solidarity trial reports and interim results. Very recently on 16th October 2020. Solidarity is an international clinical trial to help find an effective treatment. It is launched by WHO and partners. It is one of the largest international randomized trials for COVID-19 treatments, enrolling almost 12,000 patients in 500 hospital sites in over 30 countries. Posted on 16th October 2020, the Solidarity trial published interim results on 15th October. It is found that all treatment evaluated, remdesivir, hydroxychloroquine, lopinavir, ritonavir and interferon, had little or no effect on overall mortality, initiation of ventilation and duration of hospital stay in hospitalized patients. Few words about cytokine storm. It is umbrella term for group of hyperactive immune response triggered by infections, complications of autoimmune or autoinflammatory diseases, cancer or therapy of cancer. Most common infections causing STOM are viral infections. Bacterial fungal infection can also be there. Viral infections like Epstein-Barr virus, herpes simplex virus, influenza virus, H1N1 2009, cytomegalovirus, and now this nasty COVID-19. Cytokine storm, lymphocytes kill viral infected cells, and interaction between lymphocytes and viral infected cells lead to increase in pro-inflammatory cytokines like IL-6, IL-12, tumor necrosis factor alpha, IL-1 beta. Result is multi-organ failure. Most prominent involvement is lung. ARDS can occur. Others like kidneys, acute kidney injury, liver involvement, CNS involvement and cardiac involvement can also be there. DIC and thrombocytopenia is also reported. A hallmark of cytokine storm is persistent fever and non-specific constitutional symptoms like weight loss, joint or muscle pain, fatigue, headache. Progressive widespread systemic inflammation lead to loss of vascular tone, that is manifested by drop in blood pressure, vasodilatory shock and progressive organ failure. Respiratory failure is most prominent feature. Management of cytokine storm. Investigations pointing towards storm are increase ferritin, CRP, D-dimer, IL-6 and LDH. Most important are CRP and IL-6. And CRP should be serially repeated. It is treated by glucocorticoids, broad spectrum immunosuppressants, but side effect is secondary infections and worsening of diabetes. Tocilizumab, IL-6 receptor antagonist, but it does not act against other cytokines like IL-12, tumor necrosis factor, etc. And NIH treatment panel also recommend against the use of tocilizumab for treatment of COVID-19. Anakirna, that is IL-1 receptor antagonist, and according to NIH treatment guidelines, there is insufficient data for favor or against its use in COVID-19. What does not work in COVID-19? Antibiotics including doxycycline, azithromycin does not work in COVID-19 viral infection except in secondary sepsis. According to Clinical Infectious Disease article, in second or third week of severe hospitalized COVID disease patients get secondary bacterial infections. But if there is more and early use of antibiotics, there may be pan-resistant infections. Hydroxychloroquine, we have dealt with in detail. Oseltamivir does not work in COVID-19. It is approved for the treatment of influenza A and B. A study in Wuhan reported no positive outcomes in COVID-19. Several trials are still evaluating it in treating coronavirus infections. What does not work in COVID-19? Ivermectin. Australian government has issued advice on inappropriate use of ivermectin for COVID-19 and stated that there is currently no enough evidence to show that ivermectin is safe or effective to prevent or treat COVID-19. Chekor et al. Also raises their concern regarding ivermectin-associated neurotoxicity, particularly in patients with hyperinflammatory state. Finally, evidence suggests that ivermectin plasma levels with meaningful activity against COVID-19 would not be achieved without potentially toxic increase in ivermectin doses in humans. National Institute of Health COVID-19 treatment panel recommend against the use of ivermectin for the treatment of COVID-19. FDA issued a warning in April 20 that ivermectin should not be used to treat COVID-19 in humans. Indication for using ivermectin is onchocerciasis, parasitic infection. Side effects of ivermectin: neurotoxicity is main concern. Serious neurological side effects like dizziness, somnolence, vertigo, tremors, headache, vomiting, seizures, ataxia, disorientation, confusional state, and coma. Other side effects like fever, itching, skin rash, joint or muscle pain, or tachycardia can also occur. What does not work in COVID-19? Lopinavir, ritonavir, which was tried in early time, but it was negative study. NIH also recommend against its use in treatment of COVID-19. National Institute of Health COVID-19 treatment guideline panel, USA, states there is insufficient data to recommend either for or against for the use of vitamin C, vitamin D, and zinc. Medscape commentary: has pandemic infected our approach to medicine? It is said by Dr. Vinay Prasad, who is practicing hematologist, oncologist and associate professor of medicine at the University of California, San Francisco. He also studies drugs, health policy, clinical trials and better decision making. Dr. Prasad is a noted critic. He said, for a sick patient with any other viral illness, without a proven treatment, I have never witnessed doctors giving 5, 6 or 10 drugs to treat the virus without any proof that it will help. I have never seen a severely ill patient with influenza, pneumonia, viral hepatitis or HIV receiving vitamin C, zinc, hydroxychloroquine and tocilizumab, all without any evidence. Thank you. Please like, share and subscribe.